Hello, today we're going to be talking about antibodies as reagents for bioanalytical chemistry. This is a really critical topic because it enables us to be able to detect reagents that don't have their own intrinsically detectable activity. So in contrast, if we wanted to detect an enzyme, we might be able to simply add its substrate and detect it, the cleavage of that substrate over time. But if you're the analyte that you want to detect doesn't have its own activity, the way that we usually choose to detect it is by binding it selectively. And we can usually do this even amidst a complex matrix like blood or say a nasal swab, as long as we have a reagent that is selective enough in its binding that we're pretty sure that it won't bind other things. And so this has really been playing out recently during the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic with the onset of the rapid tests at home, which are based on binding of proteins from the virus in nasal swabs that people can take in the comfort of their home. So the reagent that is used in those tests, as well as in the vast majority of other binding-based tests, is the antibody. And this is a protein that is made in the blood of animals, and we'll come back to that later, that binds to other targets, which we commonly call analytes in the field of analytical chemistry. But in terms of antibody nomenclature, they're called antigens. So an antibody binds to an antigen, which is its target. So we're going to go into more detail about a few of these things now. And the first is what we want to be able to learn about the structure of antibodies and how they work, because this comes up over and over again as we're working with them. You'll often see antibodies abbreviated as a type of Y shape, which I'm going to draw here as soon as I can get my pen. Okay, so you'll often see antibodies written like this, but this is really just an abbreviation. The true structure is a little more complicated. So we have multiple chains in the antibody. There's two chains like this that are quite long, and then another two chains that are shorter. Okay, and so these each have a name. Each long chain is actually called the heavy chain, because it has a larger molecular weight than the other chain, which is called light chain. Okay, so that's easy. The nomenclature comes from when these were being run on gels originally. Okay, so there's regions here where these are connected, right? So these are four separate chains. So there's regions with disulfide bonds here. And that region where they're linked together, I very deliberately put it under the Y part of the antibody, that is called the hinge region. And there's actually some flexibility to the structure there that enables the antibody to be able to bind its target better. And so you might have one or two or four disulfide bonds in the hinge region. And then you also have disulfide bonds, maybe a couple of them linking the heavy and light chains together up here at the top, okay? All right, so now there continues to be more nomenclature for the regions of these antibodies as well. So I'm gonna draw a fresh copy so that I can label it from a different perspective. Okay, and so this back end of the molecule, this is called the FC region. And it stands for fragment crystallizable, or crystallizable fragment. And that's because this is a region that has a fairly constant packing, and people were able to make crystals of this fragment of the antibody, crystallizable. And this is another, sometimes you'll also hear it called constant region. That's another use of the word C. And that's because it has constant sequence between different copies of the antibody. And this is sort of the back end of the antibody that binds receptors that are present on cells. Receptors specifically for the antibody. And what that means is that when we're thinking about antibodies as a bioanalytical reagent, we're usually not thinking about the FC region as being the part that's going to bind our target. Instead, we pay attention to this part up here, which is the antigen binding fragment, so AB. Okay. And specifically, where all of the actual antigen binding happens is at the very tips of of these reagents. And so here is where we would actually be able to bind the antigen. And in fact, there are two binding sites, which I just drew. And this region of the antibody, where it actually binds to the antigen, is sometimes called the CDR region, because there's loops in the protein there that are called CDR loops, and that's what actually binds to your antigen. Okay, so this particular antibody that I've drawn is actually bivalent, because it can bind to two antigen binding sites. Okay, so we could draw our antigen is up here, for example, and it's binding. And here's another copy of the antigen. Okay, AG for antigen in this case. All right, so we've learned about the FAB, or sometimes people will call that Fab, and then the FC region. We learned about the heavy and the light chain. It's worth noting that one could have a single Fab fragment of the antibody that looks like this. So it's just one arm of that Y-shaped area up front, or you could have the two arms still linked together with their disulfide bonds at the base with the hinge region, and this is called an FAB2. Okay, because you have two arms now. All right, so you'll see this different nomenclature. Now there's some canonical molecular weights for antibodies that are worth knowing. Okay, so a single heavy chain canonically has a molecular weight around 50 kilodalton, and a single light chain has a canonical weight around 25 kilodalton. And so if we add that up, we have two heavy chains and two light chains. So the whole antibody has a total molecular weight. You can do it in your head and see if you got it right. It's around 150 kilodalton. Now, this is just a rule of thumb. Some antibodies are a little lighter, some are a little heavier, especially if they're glycosylated. They might vary in molecular weight depending on how they were made. But generally, they're all pretty close to 150 kilodalton. Okay, and what that means is that a single Fab fragment ends up being also around 25 kilodalton. Yes, and the FAB2 will be around 100 kilodalton. Okay, so these are sort of the canonical weights for the different fragments of the antibody, and that can be really useful if you're working with just a portion of it as we go along. Okay, all right, so that is a lot of vocabulary that goes with antibodies and then the associated molecular weights. And I'm gonna move on to how antibodies are made. So I mentioned that these are blood-based proteins. And in fact, we still make them by immunizing an animal with the target antigen. So we still don't have the ability to design an antibody from scratch in the laboratory, know exactly what the sequence should be for the entire 150 kilodaltons, and then just make it. We still rely on evolution to the evolutionary machinery to make these for us in animals. But then once we have them, we can make them recombinantly, which I'll show you in a minute. So the antibodies are made by injecting an animal, say a rat or a mouse, occasionally a rabbit, with the target antigen. And then a few weeks later, maybe after repeated vaccination and boosting, they'll do a blood draw and collect the serum. And then all of the antibodies can be isolated from the serum and purified away from the other proteins. And then you isolate further just the ones that bind to your target antigen by binding those to beads, let all the other ones wash out, and then you can recover the ones that bound to the beads. And what you have is a purified mixture of antigen-specific antibodies. And this yields a type of antibody called a polyclonal antibody. What that means is that it can bind to many different locations on the original antibody. You'll notice that we have to rely on immunization every time and blood draws every time to get these antibodies. And so it's also possible to arrive at antibodies a different way, which is where we still start with immunization of the animal, but now instead of collecting antibodies directly from the blood serum, and here we collect cells, B cells that are producing antibodies fuse them with an immortalized cell line, meaning one that will divide forever, and that creates a type of cell called hybridoma. And once those are made, now they can produce antibodies in culture essentially forever. And so these are called, these hybridoma cell lines create antibodies that are called monoclonal. And if you separate out the different hybridomas into purified groups, then what you have is each hybridoma cell line generates a single type of antibody. That is called a monoclonal antibody, meaning that it binds just one site on the antigen. And each of these is assigned a clone number. And it's these clone numbers are basically alphanumeric codes that identify the antibody in question. Okay, so we have polyclonal antibodies and monoclonal antibodies, and these differ in terms of how they're made and the number of sites on the antigen that it is binding. So I wanna go just a little bit more into clones. So for example, a typical clone number might be something like GK1.5 or some other series of letters and numbers. And so this is analogous to the Cas number that you may be familiar with for small molecules. So it tells you exactly what the monoclonal antibody is. And if you want to buy from different vendors, you need to get the exact same clone. What I mean when I say that it binds the same epitope is worth spending a little time on. So let's say that your antigen target is a protein, maybe a large protein. And so it has many different faces of that protein. Whoopsie, many different places where an antibody might bind, for instance. And so maybe one clone can bind over here. This is clone one. And if you have a monoclonal antibody, then all of the antibodies will always bind that same spot on all the copies of the antigen. Oops. So all of them can only bind that one spot. Okay. So that's a monoclonal. But in contrast, a polyclonal antibody is actually a mixture of many different clones, where now we have maybe a red clone and it can bind over here. And then maybe we also have an orange clone and it can bind somewhere else. And so the polyclonal is actually a mixture of antibodies. And as a reagent, that has some pros and cons. It's a lot less sensitive to small variations in the antigen, for example, because even if one of the antibody clones can't bind, the others will still be able to bind. But it's also a lot less controlled. And so you kind of get a trade-off in control versus robustness with monoclonal versus polyclonal. All right. So there's a few different types of antibodies that are worth knowing if you're going to be working with them as reagents. And if this was an immunology class, we could go into great detail on the biological function of each of these. But from a chemistry point of view, we mainly want to know differences in their structure, size, and affinity, because that's what will affect their use as reagents. Okay. So the first one to know is IgG. This is the most abundant and is in fact what we've been drawing this whole time. So the classic Y-shaped antibody that acts on its own as a what we say a monomer, meaning one antibody is what's binding at a time, that's the IgG. And it's actually the majority of the antibodies that are found in the blood. And this can be present with a range of affinities from nanomolar being a high affinity antibody or even less than nanomolar, all the way up to micromolar affinity, which would be considered kind of a poor binder. Okay. And again, here's those several different So even within this one isotype, the IgG, there's actual multiple subclasses of IgG that can be present. And from an analytical chemistry standpoint, we don't really worry too much about the difference of these, but biologically, they'll have different functions in the immune response. But from a reagent point of view, they'll all function basically the same, but you need to know which one you have so that you can keep getting the same one every time. Okay. The other major type of antibody that plays a role as a reagent is IgM. And IgM gets made earlier in the immune response, and so it's a lower affinity binding reagent, but it tends to be very high in what we call avidity, which means that it binds in many places at once, and therefore tends to stay on really well. So high avidity means strong binding, but not because any one copy of the antibody has a high affinity. It's really just because it can bind many at once. And IgM in particular, it forms pentamers. And so you can see a structure of that here, where five antibodies tend to be linked at their Fc chains by a series of disulfide bonds. And so they can all bind at once. And so now you have 10 places to bind the antigen at once. There's a few other types of antibodies that we won't go into, but I'm just pointing them out in case you see them so you're not confused. These are other isotypes, but they're usually not used as analytical reagents. All right, so if you were going to buy a reagent at the store, for example, so you're going to a vendor online and you're looking to buy a reagent, there are several parameters that you need to know in order to buy the correct reagent. The first one is, of course, what are you targeting? So let's say you're making an assay to detect a protein called TNF-alpha, which is an inflammatory protein found in the blood and is something that is measured in order to assess, say, autoimmune status and an inflammatory status. So if you want to know that, you would say, I need an anti-TNF-alpha antibody. But you're not done. If you say that, it's equivalent to saying, well, I want a house, but you don't know if you want a one-story house, a two-story house, does it need to have a porch, does it need to be clean, does it? So there's a lot more to specify, okay? One of the things to specify is what species was it made in? Remember, these antibodies are made by vaccinating an animal. So is it made in a mouse, a rat, a hamster, for example? You need to know the species of the target. So are we trying to detect human TNF-alpha for clinical assays? Do we want to detect it in mice for preclinical assays? What are we asking about here? And so, for example, you'll see listed, or you would put together something like this. You would say, well, I need mouse anti-human TNF-alpha. And what that means is it was made in a mouse against human TNF-alpha. So human TNF being target and mouse being the host. You would want to specify the antibody, the isotype of the antibody. For example, maybe it's an IgG1, and whether you need it monoclonal or polyclonal. If it's monoclonal, then you would specify a clone number like GK1.5. Okay, all right. Beyond that, antibodies also should be characterized either by you as a user or by the vendor in terms of what applications they've been validated for. So for example, is this going to work in an assay like ELISA, where your antigen is in its fully native state, or is it made for something in Western blot where the antigen has been denatured? And so in some cases, an antibody will work in one of those contexts and not the other. So it's important to pay attention to what applications it was validated for. And finally, is it conjugated to anything? So for example, does it have a fluorophore attached to it or a biotin group attached to it for downstream use? And so all of these things are things that you would want to pay attention to as you're selecting out the right reagents. Now, I want to point out this statement about antibodies are not magical. This is really important because maybe 15 or 20 years ago when antibodies were really being pumped out commercially as a major commercial industry, I think many chemists and engineers thought that antibodies, well, they say that they're against, say, TNF-alpha. That means they're going to bind the TNF-alpha every time and they'll only bind TNF-alpha. But that's not true. Antibodies may fail to bind, perhaps if they if the vial hasn't been taken care of properly or it wasn't produced properly. And it may also bind off-target things. Maybe it'll bind other proteins that are in the sample. And so these things are really important to characterize in your own assay. And that's where that validation idea comes back. All right, so the last item that we need to talk about is how to store and handle antibodies so that they are kept at prime binding capacity. Okay, so the first one is just stability. Antibodies are pretty nice reagents in that they can be stored at, in the refrigerator for months or even years, as long as they're kept sterile. They are sensitive to protease activity. So if they become contaminated with microbes, then eventually they'll get degraded. You can keep them out on the bench at room temperature for up to a few hours, but if you leave them out overnight, they'll usually go bad, meaning that they won't bind anymore. And for long periods of storage, like years, it's best to freeze them, but they should be aliquoted before freezing to avoid freeze thaws. As with any protein-based reagent, they need to be stored at physiological pH and salinity. And because they're proteins, they are prone to nonspecific binding, say to plastic or glass. And what that means is that it's best to store them at fairly high concentrations, like 1 mg/mL or 0.5 mg/mL, and or use a stabilizer protein to help block the surface of the tube that it's in. And people will often use, say, bovine serum albumin or polyethylene glycol or glycerol for this. Okay, so my last tip is how to keep your antibodies from getting messed up. So say you're training the newest member of your laboratory. What do you want to tell them not to do? Don't leave the antibodies out overnight. Don't freeze-thaw them repeatedly. And then if you're trying to do something like add a fluorophore or other conjugation to them, be conscious of the fact that over-conjugation may obstruct the binding site. And finally, you wouldn't want to store them at too low of concentration, say a microgram per mil would be considered low. If you want to store them like that for very long, you need to add a stabilizer to avoid surface adsorption and loss. All right, so that is it. I hope that this was useful for you, and feel free to leave any questions in the chat.